The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Let's just pray. Father, in the name of the Lord, I just thank you that this is going to be the best sermon ever. You just laid it upon my heart and gave me a download, and I'm excited, and I'll probably preach it other places. It's that real to me right now. In Jesus' name, amen. The title of the message is The Missing Fruit. I remember hearing I think it was Rick Joyner, and several others have said the same exact thing. The church is known for many things. Love's not one of them. Do you believe that? And yet by your love, you'll be known. And by their fruit, you'll be identified. So I think it's time to understand that there is a solution to this, not just the problem. I'm a solution-oriented person. I don't know about you, and I believe that Kingdom Life Church and Full Stature people, that for this reason, God chose me from before the foundation of the earth to reveal his Son in me in such a way that I would give practical application to the things that you already know you're supposed to do. And believe it or not, on a lot of our books and materials that are out there, I'd read the comments that come from around the world on some of our books. And one that was kind of prevalent that I felt really was perceptive was the one that said, here's somebody, and this is someone who had been in the church 40 years, here's someone telling us how to do what we already knew we were supposed to do. We have biblical literate people for the most part. Sometimes I wonder if you watch Facebook, you get scared sometimes. So, you know, and of course, if it's on Facebook, it's got to be true, right? Yeah. Okay. I wish people would do better research. Really, they pull from these blogs of people who make up stuff, and people pass it on as truth. And it reminded me when I was in the factory, that was my first terror of the multitudes, was when I worked in a factory. And guys would read these rag magazines, you know, woman gives birth to alien. Well, it's got to be true. It's in the paper. And I'm going, now we have a new generation. Now we believe everything that's on Facebook. It's got to be true. It's on Facebook. It's scary out there. I'm hoping that there is going to be a generation that are going to go more by discernment and know how to investigate a matter, not just... If you look at the sources, some of these people getting all excited about certain issues, and you look at the source, and it's, you know, no name, I'm a phony.com, you know, and they get all excited. So anyway, having said all of that, let's get to the truth. Let's get to Jesus. Jesus and his word are one. Jesus is the truth. And I believe that what God is basically going to deal with us is on discovering the missing fruit. You want to discover the missing fruit today? You want to remove the barriers that are actually hindering us from moving forward and upward. And if you've had a counseling background or you've done that, I'm going to upset you because you're going to have to throw it away, because what we're teaching is how to avoid a lot of counseling by abiding. If you would learn to abide, you would eliminate 90% of all that we call Christian counseling. I guess there'll always be financial counseling, marriage counseling, that kind of thing. But in reality, most of what people call getting ministry, for the most part, could be eliminated if you learn to abide in God. If it was really important to make Jesus Lord in your life, not just your Savior, and then do whatever you want, but Lord. So I believe that God's going to teach us two things. And that is, if I can do it, so can you. As a young pastor even, people would say, Dennis, you're an equipper, not an enabler. And I took that as a compliment. But I said, so God, where did that come from? And basically the Lord just said, because Dennis, you really believe in your heart that if you can do it, so can anybody else. That it doesn't take special people. We all have the same equipment. You have an anointing that abides within, which means the Holy Spirit can teach you to do the same things anybody else can do. All right. Obviously, there's different gifts and callings. There's fivefold ministry and there's such. But by and large, God wants you to tap into the fruit of the Spirit as easy as breathing. I can do that. And most of you can. And the ones that can't, you're going to learn, right? Tapping into the fruit of the Spirit is as easy as breathing for me. If it's as easy as breathing for me, if I can do it, you can do it. It's learnable. If there's such a way of saying it like that, right? You can learn. The byproduct of learning to tap into the fruit of the Spirit through abiding in Jesus, the byproduct was emotional healing. And emotional healing for me is as easy as breathing. That is not a common statement in the church. Why? Because what we have to turn around is the fact that, and we've done this with the children's books, and the children have proved it to the adults, that we teach them how to think and we teach them how to act. We even teach them how to talk, but we haven't taught them what to do with their emotions. And the younger generation, when they learn how to bring those emotions under the lordship of Jesus, they're going to walk in a spiritual growth and health beyond anything you've known before, because you cannot spiritually mature beyond what your emotions allow you. There are many gifted people who shoot themselves in the foot because emotionally they've got issues and they don't know how to resolve them. Well, I'll tell you what, we've got the tools, and so do you, and people that have been trained by us have the tools. It's going to be kind of fun even going to this 50-plus seminar. As a workshop, I'm going to take all my pastors and minister at the tables. They said, so no matter how big the crowd is, I've got a good dozen people that are competent. So it won't be just me and Jennifer. Any volunteers? And come, just minister to these people. Just give them simple how-tos. So I'll be looking for you there, and we can get a lot accomplished, a lot of breakthrough. We can have a multitude of people ministering to these people. You have something, and all you lacked was opportunity. And many of you are ministering to your family and to your children. I'm real proud of the parents that are teaching their children how to remove the pain that's in people's lives. Little children go to school with a tummy ache. In my generation, previous generations, and the current generation, but nobody's ever taught them what to do with it. It's not a tummy ache. They're not sick necessarily physically. They're emotionally upset. I don't know if I'm going to have friends. I don't know if I'm going to get a new teacher this year. I don't know what I'm going to do. And nobody's teaching them how to resolve that until now. And today, we're going to give you a hands-on message that I think you ought to get the CD and play it over again, and give it away to someone else, because we've hit on some, we don't have all the answers, but we've got an answer that's a major tool to set the body of Christ free. Tapping into the fruit of the Spirit is as easy as breathing. Tapping into emotional healing is as easy as breathing. All right, but we're going to teach you, one, we're going to have to re-educate the adults. That's why children are easier. You can educate children because they're starting fresh. Plus, they don't have the baggage. They don't have the unresolved conflicts that you bring into everyday life. All right? Yet. But if they're given the tools, they're going to know how to handle some of the most horrific and traumatic situations that can happen to anybody in anybody's life. They're going to know how to process. They're going to know how to get close to Jesus and emotionally remove the hurts and the pain. Jesus took your pain and your sorrow. You have to learn how to allow him to do it. We've even seen people try to form a bad theology that, oh, well, Jesus will remove it whenever he wants to. You know what that's based on? That's based on their own experience of having a hard time forgiving, having a hard time getting rid of their emotional pain. So they think Jesus is just taking his sweet old time and does it sovereignly whenever he wants to. That's ridiculous. That's like saying, because basically what we're talking about is bitterness in the heart is sin. So what? God's not going to deal with sin right away. He's going to take away that bitterness when he feels like it, sovereignly? Come on. Take personal responsibility for what's going on in your own heart. That's your heart. That's your territory. That's your jurisdiction to take personal responsibility. How many want to go there? How many want to believe? How would you like, how many believe you can tap into the fruit of the Spirit as easy as breathing? I like that. People raise their hand. The church at large would not raise their hand on that one. That's, people are learning. How many have found that emotional healing's easy? Raise your hand. The only people that don't find it easy have a will problem. And there's a solution to that. The solution is, Part of me wants to forgive and part of me don't. Well, you know what? Agree with the part that wants to. It's not that hard. The new creation, you, loves God and loves his word, wants to do it, right? Or you wouldn't even be asking for help, right? But then when you go to get the help and you have to let Jesus take the forgiveness, he is the forgiver, go to the pain, through the pain, and release forgiveness to someone who doesn't deserve it, this thing here gets in the way and goes, I don't know if I want to. Well, that's like saying, I don't care what Jesus wants. I don't care what the word says. So then, you know what? You're the only ones that don't get better. Everyone else has the same potential to get set free. Here's an article, and this article, we've been practicing it for decades, but this now it's even like in your USA Today. Matter of fact, this article is taken from USA Today. The evidence has been piling up throughout history. We've known this. I knew this in the School of the Spirit. Neuroscientists have proved it's true. The brain's wiring emphatically relies on emotion over intellect in decision-making. All right, science is finding that out. You know how the Holy Spirit taught me as a baby Christian? He showed me that when I would go into prayer and I would feel his presence, that if all of a sudden there was a yuck, like I would picture my foreman at work, and there'd be an upset feeling like I had a problem with my foreman, I would feel that problem down here and see that foreman in my mind's eye, and I knew that every thought, even if it's kind of bland, every thought has a corresponding emotion. We were made that way. We were made thinking, feeling, willing beings, and they're all connected. And I found out that until I removed that yuck about my foreman, I had no ability to really see that foreman up here without the torment here. And it was so easy that I found out that Jesus the Forgiver lives in me, and any yuck in me can be removed as easy as breathing. I do not have to go to counseling for 6 months over one little owie. That's been the way. Do you believe Christians can make it harder than it is? We've done that with everything. We did that with tongues. We did that with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We did it with salvation. History proves that in the restoration of the church, as God tries to renew truth to the church, Christians are always there trying to make it harder than it really is, which, by the way, will always be the battle because there's religion. I see so much religion when I look at Facebook and I see people's theology. I see a bunch of angry people. I'm not impressed. Where's the love? Huh? Really? There's nothing meaner on the face of the earth than an angry religious person. And just ask Jesus. Who did he have? Who were the angriest people around him? And it was those religious people, right? Gnashing their teeth all the time. Gee, that can't be good for you. So, the study showed that the brain's wiring emphatically relies on emotion over intellect in decision-making. That is not the way we teach it in the church. But I think we better start, because it worked. It worked in the Spirit, in the School of the Spirit, and now science is validating it. If that's the way we're wired, then we can't skip the topic of emotions and teach people how to think, how to act, how to talk, but not what to do with those emotions. Isn't that a blind spot, wouldn't you say? A major blind spot? If emocognition, emovolition, that's the way it would be, that's when Jennifer studied the physiology of it, because she wanted to know she had all the training as a Christian counselor. She was licensed secularly and with all the Christian, and she wanted to know, why is what Dennis doing go like this? And why is everything I was taught takes weeks, months, and years? And she said, because Dennis starts with the emotion. He doesn't start with the thought. Almost all models have a tendency to want to, not all models, but most of them, even if they deal with the emotion, don't thoroughly have it removed. I've seen people cry that didn't get healed. I've seen people come forward to an altar. Bawling does not mean you necessarily remove the pain. It means you identified with the pain. Identification is not ministry. It's when it's presented to to the Lord in your heart through death, burial, and resurrection, and it changes to peace. That is a supernatural exchange that tells you a transaction took place that was spiritual, not mental assent. So, studies have showed that framing how a question is posed for such a time as this, negative political ads, for example. It shows decision making. It's how it's said. Think about it. If Jason, you and Mandy went in and you were going to buy a new suit, and Mandy said, "That's a crummy suit," and you liked the suit, that's why you picked it out. Did you know that the emotion there's going to be a warfare going on emotionally about that suit? The subject is not the suit. The subject is the power behind the statement, how it was framed, how it was said. That's why you see so many negative political ads. They know it works. They suck in the negative so easily. You could even make stuff up and they'll suck it in. Believers should know better. Brain images reveal that the amygdala, which is a neural region that processes strong negative emotions such as fear, fired up vigorously in response to each 2 seconds on the average decision a person makes. Okay? When people resist it, the brain region connected to positive emotions such as empathy is one response. Another is activated when people face choices lit up as well, seeming to duke it out over the decision. Duking it out over the decision. Matter of fact, Jennifer even did some research where there was a man who had a brain injury that damaged the emotional center in the brain. And he could hardly make a decision. It was almost impossible to make any decision. The emotions control your thinking and the emotions control your choices. It also explains Romans 7, doesn't it? The things I want to do, mind will, I don't do. There's another force. And even if you have good discipline and you're able to override it, let's say you override it, like, I'd like to kill that guy. No, go to jail. Okay. All right? You can rationally override that emotion, but guess what? That emotion didn't die. That anger went inward and it's still there. It doesn't go away just because you rationally overrode it and said, I better not kill that guy. I'll go to jail. And I'm going to allow that bitterness to get buried alive. And what happens when it gets buried alive? It's there. And it doesn't take much to get your attention later on when someone interrupts you. There's that ready to kill again. Comes right to the surface. It gets fortified. Now, everyone showed emotional biases, more or less. No one was totally free of bias. But everyone among the participants who were aware they were inconsistent in decision-making say, I know I just couldn't help myself. Isn't that Romans 7? The things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't want to do, those things I'm doing. I just can't help myself. Or like Flip Wilson, an evil comedian, used to say, the devil made me do it. All right? Blame. Blame it on somebody other than yourself. All right? So, and then, in other words, this study comes amidst a burst of research into neuroeconomics, which studies the brain's role in buying and selling. So don't think advertisers aren't going to use this for marketing purposes. How they frame the statement they say to you is to reach you emotion, not just the thought processes. I mean, just how effective would this be? You want it, buy it. If not, forget it. You probably wouldn't want it, but they'll know a way. You deserve a break today. You really need to get away. See, appeal to the baser nature. Appeal to the emotional behind it. That's right. I deserve a break today. I deserve to get away. You see how framing it can be powerful? But that's the manipulation. That's the way of the world. I want to see something superior under the lordship of Jesus that can identify that and cut through it and not give in to it. All right? So, Unless we learn to deal with our emotions, we're going to have a difficult time living your Christianity. That's the bottom line. Because emotions are the key to it all, and the church has been taught to ignore the emotions. And they have a half-truth. What has the church said for decades? You can't live by your emotions. You can't live by your carnal emotions. But then again, where's the fruit? Why did God give us emotions? He gave it to us for the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is the constant presence of the love nature of God, whether it's peace, joy, all of the fruit of the Spirit are merely a manifestation of love. Peace is nothing more than the love resting inside. Joy is nothing more than the love inside rejoicing. It's all love, and it's all the nature of God. And when God took me to the school of the Spirit, he basically said that an abiding lifestyle requires a maintenance or a maintaining of the peace of God. Peace is the fruit. And when you maintain the peace, you are abiding in God. You abide in me. And that peace is not just passive. It's not weak. It's actually very militant and very powerful. So when you abide in the presence of God, you can sense the supernatural peace of his presence. The gift that Jesus gave, he said, my peace I give you, and I'm never going to take this away. When you lose your peace, guess who walked away? Not Jesus. You allowed some person, place, or thing to draw you away and gave into it. And until you learn how important the emotions are, you will continually just try with willpower to be better. And that's what we call stress. And by the way, stress means you're emotionally controlled by people and circumstances. So you still have an emotional problem. So when we sense that supernatural, or he says, I'll never leave you or forsake you, he really means I'll never leave you or forsake you. So in other words, you don't have to call out to heaven. He is within, and you can return there at will. And what we, the term we use, of course, is when this stuff starts drawing you away, and with people and circumstances, and your five senses are shouting at you, you want this, look out for this, look. You drop down to his Spirit. You draw nigh to him, and he draws nigh to you. And greater is he that's in you than he is in the world. Peace is possible in light of any person or situation. It's just a question of will you practice. Practice makes permanent, but it's not going to be a permanent part of your life without the practice. So any negative emotion separates us from the peace. And this is the way I learned it in the school of the Spirit, and now science is backing up. Jennifer got all excited because she could corroborate it, not just scripturally. I could corroborate it scripturally, but she was corroborating it physiologically, the way we were made. Even science agrees with this. But when I would close my eyes as a baby Christian and God says, I'm taking you to the school of the Spirit, and I would feel his presence, like I said, any negative emotion, even if I couldn't even put a name on it, like yuck, you know, upset, knot. Men, this is one we use often, a knot in my gut, a fist. I don't know what that is at the time, but I knew this, that when I let the Jesus in me say, God, that's a barrier between what you and I have together. That's interfering with a romance of wills, my will and his will. So I would yield, and he took away the wall, the barrier, the knot, the fist. There's no real language for some of these things other than the fact it is coming between me and my Jesus. Do you realize how little percentage of the church deals down here? They deal up here. They wrestle with thoughts, and they quote scriptures about the weapons of our warfare, not carnal, but mighty through God, the pulling down of strongholds. But if you don't deal with the emotion controlling the thought, you really do not cast that thought down. It's going to come right back with power. A lot of times more power, because you're feeding that emotion. It doesn't die. It gets buried alive. So anything toxic was quickly washed out by forgiveness. Now, let me encourage you something. When I talk about abiding and maturing in the things of God, what I found that was really exciting for me was at first I was asking for forgiveness constantly, even telling God, oh my goodness, I got so much yuck. I have an opinion on everything I see and hear. Everything I see and hear goes, and I'm going, I can't live like this. I've got to go to work. I got to concentrate on my job. But God basically taught me to release the forgiver. let go, yield the will, and let it go. And what I found, a beautiful thing started happening. I later found out it was called sanctification, but I didn't know that. But a beautiful thing started happening. I was forgiving what seemed to be constantly. The forgiveness periods were getting farther apart. And I was walking in a new sense of God's peace and his rule. Still blew it, but I liked it that the periods of time of blowing it was getting farther apart. That gave me an internal motivation to keep on doing it and saying, this works. Don't you love it when God begins to do something, anything in your life, when you've even learned this stuff, and all of a sudden, this works. That was Jennifer. She put that on the back of one of our books. I don't know about you, but I don't want no dead-end trails. This works. I'm not trying other stuff. So as soon as the heart was cleansed, peace was instantly restored. And peace is the peace of his union and communion and lordship. Let the peace of God rule. It's internal evidence that he's Lord at that moment anyway, until you blow it. He's Lord. And what I found was that I was getting more and more proficient at it. And at one time in my life, I'm not sure how many years I was a believer, but it was like the cord or the cable was cut. Instead of going up and down, drop down, up in your head, drop back down, up in your head, drop back. It was like it was cut. And it was almost like you can hold the heart open continuously or prayer unceasingly. Is a possibility. Praying unceasingly for me was practicing his presence, not talking and saying prayers. Prayer is being with a person more than it includes talking and dialogue, but that's not the whole thing. So it basically came to where any toxic feeling that was removed, I found out that you could get so proficient at this that most of the time did not require forgiveness. As I matured in the Lord, I found out I was dealing with it as temptation. I would feel this, yuck, I ain't going there. Well, that person just said, I'm not taking that in. That's really the way you should be living as a Christian. Not just in a constant state of forgiveness, but if the constant state of forgiveness is truly, in fact, working in you, you start walking in a militant ability to resist effectively. To the degree that you resist with the Word and the Spirit, you mature. Sanctification. Maturation. You want to talk about maturity? You cannot be spiritually mature more than your emotions allow you. You can have a lot of Bible knowledge. But the Lord told me, and the most loving thing he said, the thing that kept me on right track, was every time I felt any topic in my head had a corresponding emotion of anything that wasn't the fruit of the Spirit, was Dennis, don't let anything come between what you and I have together. Isn't that a nice love? What he was showing me was that if, as an act of my will, I would let Jesus carry it away, then I was engaging in a romance of wills. This is where your will is, by the way, because we found that was another thing that was disappointing. When we traveled to churches, 98% thought their will was here. This is the door of the heart. This is where Jesus came in. This is where the conscience is. This is where the seat of the emotions are. This is where the door of your spirit is. It's here, it's here, it's here. This is called your head. I watched Rodney Howard Brown do that on Sid Roth. He went to his audience, okay, this is your head. This is your spirit. Big difference, huh? I don't know if he said it with that accent, but that's what it sounded like to me. And I love it. And then later we saw, I like to coin his expression, Paul Keith Davis. We were teaching on the gut and the belly in a conference in Connecticut, and he went up and he said, this is the historical record. This is the heavenly record. David was a man after my own heart who will do all my will. Historically, I go, David didn't do all his will. But you know what? If David was clean down here, the heavenly record said, he's clean. He's clean. When you feel clean down here, the historical record is to remind you, don't want to do that again, David, right? But down here, when I think about it, I've got peace. That's what? A testimony. Not only do I have peace, but I've got supernatural anointing. So if I say, you know, I once was a drug addict, and while I'm talking about those drugs and that addiction I was in, I've got supernatural peace and anointing down here. It's going forward and touching people's lives and is potentially delivering other people. But you can't give something you don't have. And you don't have it until you've got a supernatural exchange in the gut. All these years, the church has, we don't need those feelings. And I'm telling you what, it's been a trap. Nothing like, you know how many people I've seen that were quality Christians, sincere Christians, who tried for years to deal with a mental stronghold by going, perfect love casts out fear, perfect love casts out fear. I'm always afraid, but I want to renounce that lie. I'm not afraid. And everything coming from them is fear. You can say all the right answers, but there's no supernatural exchange. Fear is still being fortified in every word that's coming out of your mouth. Every word, every thought has a corresponding emotion. I am so glad God said, I'm going to take you to the school of the Spirit, and wouldn't let me go to the Bible school I wanted to go to at that time, because I would have had to relearn some things. And I'm glad he did it his way, because now it's benefiting the body at large. Don't let anything come between what you and I have together. And you know what? You cannot have a relationship, good or bad, without the emotions. It's impossible. Emotions were made to be conduits for the work of the Spirit for relationship. If a mother had a baby and could detach totally from it and treat it as an it, that baby would die. Right? What do they call that? Failure to thrive? You need relationship and you need emotions, and you can't say, I don't need them. Most of the time, it just means you were damaged when you were young and you didn't get the emotional nurture you should have gotten, and you grow up thinking, I don't need anybody. We talked about that previous week on counterdependency. But the Lord told me, don't let anything come between what you and I have together. And it was the greatest truth that I had ever learned, because from that day on, my spiritual walk grew beyond my peers. They would come and wanted to know, how did I learn this? And how did I do that? And how did I do that? And all I said, all I know is that anything in my gut that is not the peace of God or the fruit of the Spirit, joy, is coming between me and God, and I don't want it. It was that simple. And Jesus, the forgiver, lived in me, and he would take my pain, he would take my sorrow, he would take it every time, and I didn't have to wait for when he got around to it. That's a bad theology. If I got bitterness in my heart toward my foreman at work, then I have a responsibility to receive forgiveness for having that bitterness and let Jesus remove it. Jesus will remove it, but thinking that he'll just remove it when I'm good and ready, or when he's good and ready. That's based on your bad experience. That's not based on the Bible. All spiritual reality is a matter of the heart. The heart of the matter are matters of the heart. Here's your Bible heart. This is your Bible heart. This is not your Bible heart. There's only one verse of Scripture that pertains to this. Men's hearts will fail for fear. You could have enough fear that this blood pumper stops. Everything else is talking about the innermost being, the bowels, the belly, the gut, all right? Even the womb is used, all right? So all spiritual reality is a matter of the heart. Salvation happens in the heart. If you believe in the heart and confess with your mouth, it doesn't matter what you confess with your mouth if you didn't believe in your heart first. If there was no supernatural exchange in here, what you say doesn't matter. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. In other words, whatever's in here, you can fool people with your words, you can fool them with your gestures, but you can't hide what's emanating, because it'll be attached on your words. What's really attached on your words. Salvation happens in the heart. Faith resides in the heart. Let us draw near to God with a true heart in the full assurance of the faith. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Acknowledge him. And he will direct your path. Acknowledge means through divine, intimate connection in the gut. Acknowledge is not up here. This lean not on your understanding. Acknowledge him in all your ways through divine, spirit-to-spirit connections, and he'll direct your path. How will he direct your path? He'll let the peace of God rule. Peace will guide your path. I have more confidence in peace guiding me and directing me than all the rational information in the world. It's proven to be more reliable. The word of God is planted in the heart. True forgiveness comes from the heart. When we traveled to churches, we found that that was the primary mistake. People were forgiving and living with the pain because they were forgiving from mental assent. They were sincere, or they wouldn't have been trying for so long to forgive. But they weren't forgiving from the heart. The Bible, Matthew 18, unless you forgive from the heart. That means if you don't forgive from here, you're just giving lip service to it, and it doesn't work. True forgiveness comes from the heart. Christian fellowship is a matter of the heart. The door of the heart is the will. I stand at the door and knock. Jesus did not stand at my forehead and knock. He stood at the door of my heart and said, Dennis, if you could humble yourself and open the door of your heart, I will come in. And he did. And then I said, I know that I know. Didn't most people say, I know that I know? You had an inner assurance, not just a mental assurance. An inner assurance, I know that I know. This is your knower. Now, the head-heart connection. We have a concept of renewing the mind. My conscience. Where's your conscience? Don't point to here. This is where your conscience. You do something wrong and I go, it gets uncomfortable here. And it shoots up to the brain. This is the second brain. It talks to that brain. All right? It gets it first. If all of a sudden we heard a loud crash in the hallway right now, boom, and you went like that, that fear went through your entire body before this even knows what happened. Emocognition, emovolition. Now, we're going to the place where the renewing of the mind. Isn't that the church talks? Well, but Dennis, you've got to renew the mind. Don't you know I've had 29,000 teachings on renewing of the mind. Has it worked? Probably not as well as it could. You know why? Because you're trying to renew the thoughts with the truth. But guess what? You already knew the truth. But when you says, I'm thinking that I'm a failure, but the Bible says I can do all things through Christ. But don't tell me you didn't know the truth. Of course you knew the truth, but it wasn't working, was it? The but is the problem. Where's the but coming from? Because I don't feel like it's true. Exactly. That's not faith. That's fear. And until you deal with that fear, that truth is never going to be written on the tablet of your heart. And you can renounce it forever, and it's never going to go away. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind. That Greek word is nous, N-O-U-S, and it means mind, will, and emotions. We have made the mistake because we exalt this almighty brain. We've exalted it to such a part where when we read those scriptures, we think only your thoughts. Renewing of the mind. No, the Hebrews knew is the renewing of the mindset, your entire mindset, mind, will, and emotions all have to be under the Lordship. You can't just have nice, happy thoughts. It's going to have to be ruled from the Spirit, mind, will, and emotions, under the Lordship, under the rule of the Spirit. Then you're not conformed to this world. Then you're transformed so that you can prove that good, perfect will of God. You know, the other thing the Lord taught me that I still run into, seasoned Christians are still afraid that if something goes wrong, they're getting punished and they're, you know, the whole thing, when God taught me to yield my will to his will, he equated the will with his pleasure. Not punishment or drudging duty. Religion does a lot of that condemnation stuff. I learned that when I yielded to his will, I yielded to a sense of pleasure and joy. His will is his pleasure. According to his good pleasure, his pleasure could be your pleasure, not drudging duty. That's your flesh. But when you yield it, your will, it's a divine romance and you enjoy his will. I got people that are been in the church for years and they're terrified that if God tells me to do this, he's going to make me unhappy. God's going to tell me to go to Africa. God's going to tell me to go to Canada. God's going to tell me. Is that what kind of a God are you serving here? Those are basically your fears and your apprehensions. He's nowhere near like that. We have a feeling thought connection. So here's where Jennifer got excited. She says, oh, in a matter of weeks, she was totally transformed. She says, basically, there is a loop. Emotions, will, and thoughts. And it's a loop. And the goal, this is so profound, is to get God in the loop. Don't you think that's a good idea? I never thought of inviting God into that situation. I was just going to tough it out myself. After all, I only ask God to do the hard stuff. Well, trust me, you're pretty hard. In and of your flesh, it's pretty hard. Why not get God into the loop? Every thought has an emotion attached to it. Like we said before, children, what do they get? Tummy aches going to school? They're upset emotionally. They may get sick, but they're not sick at that point. No one's telling them what to do with those emotions. Sometimes you can even feel butterflies in the stomach, anticipation, excitement. Oh, boy. Oh, boy, he's letting us out early. Whoa, whoa. Those little butterflies. Okay, that could be exciting. Where do you feel? Down here. This is the seat of the emotions, biblically. The seat of the emotions. There's an emotional center in your brain, but this brain-gut connection, and Jennifer's got a whole teaching on the brain-gut. This is the second brain. This is the one that produces the emotions that go through the entire body and informs the brain. The brain has to catch up. That's why firemen and policemen have found out that they've saved their lives going by the gut before the brain. They went with the hunch and found out it could save lives going with a hunch. The gut picks up faster than your brain has a chance to figure it all out. So we often make wiser decisions when you follow the gut rather than relying on logic alone. As a matter of fact, logic alone, in this day and age, it's pretty hard to get all of the facts. If I was a businessman, I'd surrender my business to the Lordship of Jesus and let the peace of God rule with contracts and business proposals and everything else, because there's so many variables. You could wear yourself out researching, and there's a point of no return to where you're never going to find enough. You're going to have to make a decision, yay or nay. Go with the gut. Do your research, but go with the gut. Don't spend forever. I had friends that loved the Lord, but they became a professional student. They never did leave school. They always felt like I didn't know enough to go into ministry. And I'm going, my God, they got every degree imaginable and they're still in school because they're afraid they don't know enough. No, their problem was they weren't allowing the Holy Spirit to teach them spiritual truth. They were relying on that intellect. They had a sharp intellect and they thought that that intellect was the answer to everything. I don't know. Look at our political system. I see a lot of intelligent people doing really dumb things. I'm not impressed, right? Jennifer says, I've never been impressed with intelligence because intelligent people can do the same stupid things that a person who's not intelligent does, only with more complications and more sophistication. So, emocognition, emovolition, the second brain. I know that I know. There's two places of knowing. This is the other knower. I want to see a people trained up that they develop this knower. This one has been developed over the years. Trust me, this one needs it more. This one desperately. It's like having something and you're not utilizing it. It's a waste. I believe we're going to stand before the Lord someday with, what did you do with what I had? And yet I said, you have an anointing. It abides in you and you shouldn't have anyone teach you. You should let the Holy Spirit teach you, and you didn't. You wanted to learn it in your head. I don't want to be held accountable for that. I wanted to know him, that I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of his personhood. That's the way you learn. We have an emotional brain in our gut that is active and important as the brain between our ears. And yeah, even the scientists are calling it the second brain. But this second brain is called the enteric nervous system. It explained a lot for me even in doing deliverance on people. Did you ever notice how they want to throw up or they get something in the throat? Huh? Guess what? The enteric nervous system is your entire gut bowel lining and the esophagus. That explains a lot of things. Then I've had people say, well, I don't get any feelings down here. I only get them in my chest and in my throat. Well, it started down here. It's just that you're not acclimated to paying attention to your emotions. by the time you feel an emotion, you're already in the shoulder blades, stressed, can't move, got a headache. That just means you don't have them under control. And you're not even paying attention. You can't teach someone that's not paying attention. You give power to what you give attention to. You start giving attention to your spirit, and you're going to start learning quickly. You will give power, and you will start learning at a rapid rate. But this second brain are connected by the left vagus nerve. There is a left vagus nerve that connects with this. Now, I often saw when I ministered to people, they would say, I need to pray through. You can feel and hear the lump in the throat, the esophagus, but it started here. You were dealing with shame issues or those kinds of things, and shame will go right up in here. It can even flush your cheeks, and you can get red, you can get embarrassed, but it didn't start there. It started here and went up. The enteric nervous system, or the second brain, it's basically nerves travel from the emotional center in the brain, the limbic system, directly to the intestines. Emotional information is transmitted to the cells by neuropeptides, or molecules of emotion. Do you ever know emotions are molecules? Like, and like I said, if something crashed, you could feel that in your entire body before your head says, oh, that was a broom that fell. It's that quick. And so it's basically that this primarily transmits emotional information from the gut to the brain, not the other way around, not the brain to the gut. So let's back up. What did Dennis learn in the school of the spirit with no teaching, no physiology? All I knew was that if I dealt with what was down here, there was no problem renewing the mind. I could, if I had peace down here, I renounce that thought that you're a failure. I would renounce it. And all of a sudden, after I renounced, I had the authority to renounce it. Why? Because I had peace. I had the rule of God. I had the authority behind that phrase, able to renounce that lie. And the beautiful thing was I learned that all of a sudden, a very loving scripture would come up and say, Dennis, you're the apple of my eye. And where I thought I had renounced I'm a failure, the apple of my eye wasn't just a cute scripture that I pulled out of a promise box. It had life on it, and I owned it, and it was written on the tablet of my heart. And to this day, I can go back and tell you all of the ones that are not in my head, they're real, written on the tablet of my heart, because I first let the negative emotion be removed, renounced the lie, and the truth would rise up. Because most people stay their whole Christian life with, I know the Bible says, but. You can live like that forever, but you don't have to. Wouldn't you like to remove the obstacle? You know what the Bible says, but you know in your head you don't believe it, which means if your head doesn't believe it, your heart doesn't believe it. So you're not going to change it in the head. You're going to change it in the heart, and then the truth has a place now. You remove the stronghold, truth can replace it. Truth cannot replace it till you remove the lie. You can't remove the lie if you don't deal with the emotion that's attached to the lie. The inner battle is actually getting God in the loop. Can you see that? In other words, whatever turmoil's going on, I've got to get God in that loop. Because when he's in the loop, everything gets renewed. Mind, will, and emotions. So Romans chapter 7, I've tried everything. Nothing helps. I'm at the end of my rope. There's no one who can do anything for me. Isn't that the real question? That's the Message translation. All right. The answer, thank God, is that Jesus Christ can and he does. He acted to set things right in this life of contradictions where I want to serve God with all my heart and mind, but I'm pulled by the influence of sin to do something different. Where does that battle come from in the life of a believer? It comes from the subconscious part of us, our hidden toxic emotions causing ongoing cycles of trouble that happen again and again. When I used to minister, after God taught me this, I just called it that same old, and found out that I could see people getting set free when I would just ask them, what's that same old thing that happens over and over again? That you may have victory in a lot of areas of your life, but then there's this same old, and everybody had some. And I'm going, those are easy to get rid of. If it's a same old, it means there's a cycle. If there's a cycle, it means it started somewhere. If you receive forgiveness from where it started, it breaks the cycle. That's the work of the cross. It's the only solution to sowing and reaping is the cross. And the cross is forgiveness through the blood of Jesus and cleansing it until you get peace. The cycle stops. You sow to the wind, you reap the whirlwind. The biggest principle in all the Bible is sowing and reaping. There's no larger, greater principle than sowing and reaping. Jesus himself said, if you don't understand this one to his disciples, how are you going to understand anything in the kingdom if you don't understand sowing and reaping? The only thing that stops sowing and reaping is the finished work of the cross when applied in your life. In other words, legally it's been done. Vitally, you need to apply it. It's available, but it needs your application. So, how can I know all the sins that are lurking in my heart? You can't. We used to minister to people, sometimes minister to a board at various churches when we traveled, and someone would invariably say, I've already dealt with anything, I don't need this. I always found that real interesting because they were dealing with the, how many? 2,000? 2,000 brain processes per second. That's what the average person deals with from the head up. 2,000. I can't think of anybody for you. You close your eyes and you go to the 400 billion brain processes that are in the non-conscious. That's why the scripture says, search me, O God, because I am too stupid to know what I need. I only think I don't have any needs. Well, let's get a second opinion and ask God. Search me, O God. And isn't this interesting? New American Standard says in Psalm 139, search me, O God, for anxious thoughts, hurtful ways. Cognition, hurtful. I mean, anxious thoughts. What kind of thoughts? Fearful thoughts, anxious thoughts. Emotional thoughts, hurtful choices. Emocognition, emovolition. If those emotions of hurt aren't dealt with, if the emotions of anxious isn't dealt with, those thoughts are not going to change. You cannot renew the mind until that's dealt with, because that's the power behind the thought. If you could memorize something, because we're word people, and word people fail at the most fundamental area in their word application. And that is, every word that comes out of your mouth has two lines. Picture this. Every word. Like if I'd say, blessed are the meek, blessed are the poor in spirit. Every word that's coming out of my mouth has two lines. One, the actual words. Two, the authority that's attached to that word. I'm more concerned with the authority attached to the word. You can't even say, well, I believe. Well, the devil believes. It's not doing him any good, is it? It's what nature is attached to what he says. The devil can quote scripture. It's not doing him any good. It's what authority is attached to the scripture. We've exalted the scripture to the point where it's almost the third person of the Trinity, when in reality, that scripture, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. All things are naked and open to the eyes of him. He's a person. The most important revelation of the incarnation is that Jesus came as a man, but he was there from the beginning as the Word. The Word was made flesh and he dwelt among us. It's not just a doctrine. It's a person. Now, these anxious thoughts and hurtful ways, when we pray, God gets in the loop. How do we get God in the loop? Come on. There's only two answers in this church that you ever have to know. How do you get God in the loop? Where do you start with? The emotion? And what do you do if the emotion is fear? Receive forgiveness until it changes to what? Peace. There you go. Forgiveness, peace. You always win. Forgiveness or peace. Peace is the evidence of the rule of God in a practical way. If he's ruling and you've got peace, then guess what? He is now in the loop. Mind, will, emotions. Mind, will, emotions. Conscience. All of a sudden you feel okay. Does anybody not want to feel okay? Even if you feel like nothing. You know what that's saying? Everything is at least in harmony right now. Try to behave and maintain that until somebody does something and you go, that is coming between you and Jesus. Where do you start? Down here. You remove it through forgiveness. You can get really good. You can remove it by resisting, going, I'm not even taking that in. I hear you knocking, but you can't come in. I feel you, but I am not going there. That's when you are actually walking in the Spirit, when you learn to resist and build spiritual muscle that way. Anxious thoughts, hurtful ways. The Bible shows there's a clear interweaving in our heart, tying together emotional thoughts and our emotional choices. David speaks of thoughts that are anxious and ways that are hurtful. The brain's wiring is emphatically relying upon an emotion over intellect and decision making. Okay? Hurtful ways means you will probably continue to do hurtful ways because hurt rules over your ways. If you let that hurt rule your ways, you will hurt people, hurt people. Healed people, heal people. Hurt people because hurt is ruling your ways. And you're going to say, I can't help myself. Exactly. But you could help yourself. Deal with the hurt and your ways will change. Deal with the anxiety or the fear and your thoughts will change. The brain's wiring relies on those emotions. In fact, people who lack emotions due to brain injuries, we talked about this at all, they have difficulty making any decision. They're trying to find, I'm making a decision, but I don't know how I feel about it. I don't know what to do. Do you realize that? The brain stores emotional memories of past decisions. That's what drives a lot of people's choices. Your past decisions over and over again has an emotion that is building and being stored up progressively to where it's easier to do than not to do. My goal is to get you to obey God to where it's easier to do than not to do. But for an addiction, it's easier to do the addiction than not to do it, correct? How did that get built? You stored up by reason of use. But I would say, God, where did this get started? Repent, bring a work of the cross to it to stop the cycle. And then practice the new cycle. You have to walk it out. You can't just speak the word. You've got to live the word. You have to walk it out. So, it's interesting because what really drives people is, thank God, some of you are rational. And you've overridden the negative emotions, but it would be even better. Real rationality is to have those emotions under control, to know that they're under the lordship of Jesus. God made us thinking, feeling, willing beings, and it's ridiculous that for so many decades the church ignores feelings. He made us a thinking, feeling, and what did he make us a feeling being for? To be problematic, he gave us feelings for the fruit of the Spirit to be experienced so that our emotions could have communion with God and actually feel the love nature. And this was the mission of the church. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and one another. Well, great. Well, we don't do feelings. How are we going to do even the greatest commandment? God is omniscient, but he's an emotional God. And he wants relationship. Do you agree he wants relationship? You cannot have a relationship without emotions, good or bad. Good or bad relationships, you cannot have them without emotions. Emotions are the conduit. We got to get God into the loop. When you get God into the loop of the emotions and he begins to rule, all of a sudden you begin to function the way you were intended from the very beginning. All things come into harmony. Your thought life gets restructured, renewed. You start thinking his thoughts. How many people saw a taste of it the minute you got saved? I don't know about you, but I was, before I got saved, and I think Jennifer was the same way. I mean, I was liberal. I was just, you know, huh?
I was conservative, but I wasn't
saved. She was always conservative. Jennifer was conservative in the womb. I didn't know what I was. I just wanted the easy way out. And in the drug culture, that's, we just, everything goes. That was my liberal. And I got saved. I didn't need anyone to teach me. All of a sudden, I started, when I asked Jesus to come in and he changed my heart, my emotions changed, my thoughts changed, and my actions changed. And it kind of surprised me at first. Like, well, I was Dennis the Menace. I was a bad kid. And all of a sudden, I wanted to do nice things. That's enough to scare my mother. Got her saved. My dad was a good man his whole life. I mean, for an unsaved man, he was better than most Christians. All right? So he looked at me and he went, well, he needed it. My dad didn't feel like he needed it, but Dennis, he needed saved. All right? So a number of years ago, Jennifer made a Bucket Man poster as a visual aid for Sunday school. And it's interesting. It's a picture of a crank with a rope wrapped around it and a hole in the middle, and was located over Bucket Man's head. And a piece of string would go down, and when the bucket was down, there was a blue cardboard that went over living water. All right? Because I can remember even the third graders going, there's no living water in your head. Even the third graders knew better, that if you want to tap into the living water, you literally have to drop down into your spirit. It's not in your head. And if it's in your spirit, it will rise up and influence your head. But there's none. This is not the source. This is the source. So they made Bucket Man. The kids ran with it faster than adults. It was easy for them to understand. And it was easier for them to understand how to let Jesus take the negative emotions and just wash them out. So Bucket Man, counsel in the heart of man. Look at where I'm pointing, because you can read these scriptures and read them all up here. Counsel in the, and it's not this heart. Counsel is in the heart of man like a deep well, but a man of understanding draws it out. So where is wisdom coming from? This is the mind of Christ, not here. And you draw it out. Revelation comes up. It doesn't go down. And out of the abundance of the heart, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. Anyone thirst, let him come and drink of me, for out of his belly will flow rivers of living water. It will be like a fountain springing up into eternal life. I mean, this should be automatic. Whoever drinks the water will never thirst. The water I give him will become in him a fountain, in him, not on top of him, in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. Everybody knows the stuff that comes on the outside, when God's basically saying, this is all coming from within. Surely I have calmed and quieted. Psalm 131:2, this is the way the Lord trained me. I was hyperactive as a child, and I was hyperactive as a baby Christian. This is the way God broke that in a very short period of time for me. He taught me to close my eyes, and my mind was going everything. I wanted to get up and pace. I didn't want to sit still. And he says, like a weaned child with its mother, I have quieted my soul within me. And God kept telling me, Dennis, you're having trouble staying dropped down. You know why? Because your mind, your will, and your emotions are your flesh is still too hyper. And until you can calm it, and I found out that, how do I calm it? You give power to what you give attention to. And I'm saying, I want to get up, I want to pace, but I'm not going to, because I am focused on Jesus, and it would fall away. And then it was like weaned. All of a sudden, getting into his presence was easy. And that was in the beginning months. And after a short period of time, I've never had trouble since. You can wean that. I close my eyes. I'm in his presence. Many of you are like that, and some of you are not. Some of you have still got to wean your active mind, will, and emotions of making too much noise. And God, here's what God used on me. He said, Dennis, you're not praying until you're weaned. Because I want to meet you spirit to spirit. I don't want to meet your head. I don't want to meet your thoughts. I don't want to meet your anxiousness. I want you to meet me spirit to spirit, and I'm not changing. I'm not getting louder. You get quieter. And so what I did was I had to resist all of that runaway energy until it diffused, because you give power to what you give attention to, and I was giving attention to Jesus in me and all that other stuff. He became more real than the world around you. He became more real than the flesh energy to want to do something, and the time would just drift away. You entered into a whole other realm in the spirit. The wounds of the heart manifest as negative emotions. Now, here's another place where you can see this, and people don't pay attention, but they should. Proverbs 18:8, the words of a talebearer. What's that mean, a gossip? All right, say, Monica's gossiping to me, and the words are coming out of her mouth, but it says in the scripture that when I hear her words, I take them in, and it goes down into the innermost, how does it say it exactly? The words of a talebearer are wounds. She says something negative about Jennifer, and they go down into the innermost parts. Monica would never do that. And they go down into the innermost parts of the belly. It would hurt down here whether the words were true or not. It's not about being true or not. It's about if I take them in. They go in. That's why a gossip is looking for someone who's open. You should basically tell a gossip, I really don't want to hear it. You should talk to the appropriate person about that. Have you gone to them? Unless you're part of the problem and the solution, you don't have any business. Yeah, Jennifer likes that one. Can I quote you on that to them? But you know what? They'll never tell you another thing. And if anybody wanted to know gossip, I guarantee you Jennifer's the last person that would know, which is a compliment. Because one time I preached in my church, and it was the most embarrassing sermon I ever had. My church was round. Some people were sitting like this. It was a dome building. And I said, I mean, if you really wanted to know the gossip and the real dirt on somebody, who would you go to? This half of the church looked toward the center, and this half looked to the center, and they all looked toward the same person. I went, OMG, as they would say, right? You don't want to be that person. That if somebody wanted to know the scoop on something, they would go to you. That means you're the wrong person in the wrong place at the wrong time all the time. And you've got a reputation for it. That is not a good reputation, is it? You are not a redemptively oriented person. You're more like a talebearer. You just can't wait to get some little morsel. And what you do is it might make you feel good about yourself, but you basically are poisoning other people. You're putting wounds that may very well go down in the innermost parts of the belly. However, the good news is, everything I'm teaching you is that most of you have wounds in the belly. You forgot about it. Just because you forgot about it doesn't mean it's still not operating. But you can ask God, search me, O God, for anxious thoughts and hurtful ways, and let him pick them one at a time and remove that. I'm believing that there are a lot of people are going to get physical healings when they allow God to pick the sequence. In other words, there's some people he might want to heal your, like we said earlier, he might want to heal your ulcer after you stop beating your wife, all right? You might need to deal with the bitterness and the anger in your heart, and then maybe you'll get your ulcer healed. You follow what I'm saying? Sequence. Let God pick the sequence. I hold my heart open for all physical healing, but I also let God search my heart to see if there's any barriers in me, any attitudes that could be standing in the way. Now, just good counsel. Search me, O God. My bowels boiled and rested not. The days of affliction prevented me. Yikes. That's Job 30:27. He's having a bad day. But if the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, righteousness, peace, and joy, that means that the kingdom of God is emotions primarily. And you say, well, righteousness. Righteousness is love in action. Love in action. Peace ruling that God is Lord. I'm going to work. I'm everything that I'm doing as unto the Lord, not just my boss. So love is in action, peace is ruling, and you know what? I'm in the will of God. There's a pleasure that I can't quite put my finger on it, but I'm doing some mundane things here on this job, but there's pleasure because his will is his pleasure. That's the kingdom of God, righteousness, peace, and joy. All are emotions, all are emotional, but they're all meant for the rule of God to be in there. Isn't that practical? Think about it. The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. Instead of quoting it, how about going to work? When I got saved, I cleaned toilets and mopped floors as unto the Lord because God sent me there. And that was not the kind of job that I wanted. But I did it as unto him because he sent me there. And you know, I could feel joy while I worked. How about in the scripture where it says, to walk worthy of the Lord, patient and steadfast in circumstances. Steadfast in circumstances, patient with people. This is Colossians 1:11. Steadfast in circumstances, patient with people, with joy. I did that. That's not pie in the sky. That was a reality for me. I got delivered off of drugs, saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, and was cleaning toilets with a college education, cleaning toilets and mopping muddy, dirty floors, and I had the joy of the Lord while I was doing that. So don't say it's impossible or it's pie in the sky. What it was is that in those circumstances, it was God's circumstance. He put me there. It was God's building. Those are God's floors. Those are God's toilets. I was working for him, not people. And I'll tell you, it'll change everything in your attitude. And I was steadfast in those circumstances. I was patient with people, and I was dealing with hijackers, drug addicts, and some truckers that were supposedly had killed people and gotten away with it and everything else. And yet, in those relationships with those people, I had peace. And I was functioning the way God intended me to function in the kingdom, righteousness, peace, and joy. So it's not far-fetched pie in the sky. It's what the church has to be brought back to. But until you can give your emotions to God, you're going to just fall back into the old habits of trying harder. And how's that been working for you? Just trying harder. I don't know. Why do I keep doing the things I don't want to do and not doing the things I want to do? Let's minister to these right now, okay? Let's do this. Some people watching by Ustream. Father, by the power of the Holy Spirit, you've caused situations to come to their mind. Pick one situation. Let God pick the sequence. Pick one situation that comes to mind right now. And when you think of it in your head, you feel a yuck in the gut. I don't care what that emotion is. I don't care if you can't define it. It's coming between you and Jesus. So let the Jesus in you, the forgiver, either release forgiveness to that person, let forgiveness flow. Yield the will. Don't try. Let. I yield the will and let Jesus, the forgiver in me, go to that feeling and through that toxic emotion and carried away. There, my peace came back. I receive forgiveness for having allowed that to stay in there for so long. I receive forgiveness. There's my peace. You feel that peace? That's the supernatural power of God. That's God saying, it's clean now. The heavenly record, it's clean. If it's clean in the gut, it's clean in heaven. Will you remember what you did, right or wrong, toward that person or situation? Yes, but when you remember it, you will have peace. Isn't that worth it? How many people can identify with someone that's really done them wrong recently? Anybody done you wrong? Close your eyes, picture that person, feel the feeling. Nod your head if you feel something other than the supernatural peace of God. Stay focused on that person. Yeah. And whatever that is, no matter how mild, it's a barrier, I let Jesus the forgiver in me go to that barrier and right through that barrier. And out of my belly flows a river of loving forgiveness. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.